Hi everybody, my name is Thierry Bultel. I'm a software architect working in a French company named IoT.bizidage. IoT stands for Internet of Things, obviously, and Bizidage stands for Brittany, which is the place where we live. The subject of this presentation is cross-debugging on Linux. In some past years, I was working for Wind River Company, and we were developing development tools, and especially I was working on the Linux user mod debugger. We will see what is available today in terms of cross debugging and also what can be expected from modern tools today. The issues addressed in this talk are obviously the remote debugging, but also we'll have a deeper look on the debugger in Twin 6. For the one who have ever wanted to know how a debugger works, it will be probably of interest. At the end of the talk, I also did a little bit about the ancient essential tools for the developers, like LTNG and Valgrind, and also we will see what and how Zephyr OS works and what kind of debug it offers. IoT.bizidage is currently developing and has recently released the official version of Wetbasque. Wetbasque is both a factory which helps developers and integrators to make product easier, and also Wetbasque OS, which is a new Linux distribution based on CentOS and that has long-term support. First, I would like to be a little more specific about what remote debugging means. Remote debugging means when you debug an application which is on a remote embedding target. Usually, this is a target which is of a different CPU architecture than your host development machine. And as a rule, considering that the target architecture is different as your host, will prevent you from bad surprises. What it is not is just connecting through SSH, for instance, on a target that has an open SSH server and to launch the debugger on it. That doesn't suit with small embedded targets, and that will also won't work if you want to do system mode debugging. In the past 15 years, I often seen people that weren't using remote debugging. There were several reasons for that. Some people were just working on code that was not architecture dependent or that was using board devices. In that case, they were able to reproduce their bug on their host. Some others said that the debugger was badly integrated in popular IDEs like VS Code, and they were right. Also, GDB and GDB Server have suffered from instabilities for years and were leading from crashes or bad performances. Some other people were very special ones because they weren't using debuggers at all, simply that because they didn't trust them or they could cope their bugs without using debuggers at all. There are two kinds of remote debugging: system mode and user mode. System mode basically means kernel debug when you are under Linux. It can be performed either with hardware assistance, with a JTAG probe, through software, things like KGDB, or software emulation, for instance when you run a KVM with a special debug port that emulates a GDB server. One thing to keep in mind is when you stop, you perform a stop that suspends the whole system. That means that you lose communication. In case of you are using a software like KGDB software debugger, that means that you will have to keep your communication alive with IRQ disabled. For doing that, the debugger implements a special communication channel based on pulling on the communication interface, like serial or Ethernet. It's interesting to notice that some high-level debugger may have what is called the OS awareness, That means that they know that the underlying debug system is Linux and that they will be able to display some thread information, register backtraces, or thread local storage. User mode debugging means application debug. Debugger relies on the Bitwise API that is built in the kernel. It's interesting to notice that since the last years, there have been several significant improvements in the Bitwise API. The signal handling is far better since Linux 3.4, and security has been improved because seccomp is handled since Linux 4.8. For using Bitwise API with GDB, you have to get the appropriate security credentials. If you have ever wanted what are the mechanics when you insert a breakpoint in your favorite debugger GUI, the things behind are that the debugger inserts a special instruction into the process memory. That instruction is completely architecture dependent, and its role is to generate a software interrupt when the program counter comes on it. The debugger will catch that software interrupt. As it maintains a list of breakpoints and the original instructions that were at their places, the debugger will be able to step over the breakpoint. Maybe the most important thing to remember here is that the process memory is modified and that can have significant side effects that I explained a little bit later. Hardware breakpoints use hardware support. The amount of available hardware breakpoints and how to use them depends on the CPU. There are of two types, instruction breakpoint, that just like software breakpoint are hit when the program counter reaches location, and hardware breakpoint, which are very useful to detect or to debug crashes due to altered memory. It is worth to notice that usually it's not a special address, but rather a range of addresses. The main advantage of hardware breakpoints is that tracing memory is not modified at all. Another important feature of a debugger backend is a single step. The single step consists in executing a single machine instruction and stopping immediately after. That feature can be supported by the hardware or not. Usually, the Linux kernel publishes that feature through the Bitwise single step call that can rely on hardware support or being emulated by the kernel itself. When there are no support at all, and it was the case on older kernel on the MIPS architecture, this is the trickiest issue, because you have to figure out what will be the next program location depending on the current instruction. You can imagine that jumps are the trickiest thing to handle. When you know the instruction, where you will go after, you have to put a temporary breakpoint on that location to resume your process, to hit that location and to remove the breakpoint. In other words, your tracing memory is modified twice, and that can lead to annoying side effects. One of the most complicated problems that debugger has to deal with is multi-thread debugging, especially when there are a lot of shared code and when you want to use thread-specific breakpoints. In both cases, you are in the same address space, so when you put a breakpoint, it will be eventually hit by a thread that was not aimed to. When this happens, the victim must be resumed. But when you want to do that, before modifying the process memory, you have to stop all the other ones. You have to suspend them. Else, you will eventually lose the breakpoint in the other thread. As you can guess, things can get even worse when you don't have hardware support for single step, but that you emulate it with temporary breakpoints. The reason why I've been working on the Linux debugger is that Windweaver wanted a debugger with an IDE whose name was Tornado that has same features as VxWorks. So everything began in 2005. The first proof of concept of a unified software debugger for Linux that was dual. It could perform system and user mode. The first proof of concept was performed a couple of months after the beginning of 2005. It consisted of a set of ugly patches on the top of 2.6.x kernel. It was using VxWorks WDB protocol and it was using serial and netpolling routines because there was no netpoll API yet. And an interesting thing, it was able to spawn processes from the kernel context, which is unusual. Today, nowadays, when the kernel wants for some reason to spawn a user process, usually uses needs help from the user land. After some months, the project was finally abandoned, and a split was made between system mode and user mode. CageLib was chosen for system mode. By the way, I would be interested to get some testimonials from the listeners if they know of themselves still use CageLib today, because I don't know a lot of people that do so. For user mode, the Ptrace API was chosen, and we started to develop an application called the User Mode Agent that was leveraging Ptrace API and implemented the WDB protocol. It was using UDP and was supporting also the TIPC protocol and also serial backend. All those architectures were supported, x86, 64, ARM 32, PPC 32, NMU 32, and MIX 64. It was possible to get the Tracy IO in the double console through the virtual console. There were support for hardware breakpoints, for ARM sum mode and interworking mode, and both flavors of threads that were available at that date, which were NPTEL and Linux threads. And the key feature, to my mind, it was possibility to have fine-grained debugging. I mean, stop, stepping, continuing on single thread without having to stop the whole process. At the end of the project, we finally achieved the following result. Our debugger was able to debug up to 100 threads with lots of shared code, and each thread could be debugged individually or not. A set of more than 2,000 units or stress tests could be run from the host debugger. Facing the complexity of the single-step emulation problem, I decided to base my design on a finite state machine. That finite state machine was holding more than 80 states, and it was possible to design it with a GUI. The debugger was and has continued to be entirely used by Windweaver developers to develop the JTAG Props firmware of the company. What you can see here is the finite state machine displaying its GUI and its complexity. That tool is quite deprecated, it's no longer maintained and was originally written by a French engineering school. I recently published the code of that application on GitHub just for it not being lost, but it's no longer maintained at all. The inconvenient of this design is that it doesn't suit for system mode debugging. Moreover, the problem of stepping over ghost breakpoints are the ones that are not intended to be hit because specific to another thread, led to performance issues with SMP. So the trick used by the other project was to step over a breakpoint or perform single-step emulation by putting or executing the execution somewhere else in another address space that was not shared with the other threads. Let's go back to the present, if you don't mind. I will show some remote debug sessions example. In the first setup, the communication will be done by a GDB running in the Redpesk local builder. The local builder is a light container that has all the developing tools, and including cross compiler when necessary, GDB and so on, and what you need to package your application into the Redpesk factory. And it will connect to an instance of Redpesk OS running in a KVM. So what you can see in the running video is that the KVM instance is booted. Meanwhile, the developer compiles a very simple application. And as you can notice in the makefile, there is a separation between the application program and the debug information. Once the target is booted, the GDB server instance is launched with the dash dash multi, which means that we don't want to close the connection when the GDB session exists, and we specify a special port. On the host, we launch a GDB, we attach to the target with the special target extended remote and the given port that has been mapped on my host because it is running a KVM. And then we'll put a breakpoint on main and load the program. We can see that the breakpoint on main is correctly hit. The following example matches the reality better. In this case, we still have GDB running on the host machine, and this time it will connect to an instance of GDB server running on an actual board. In this case, this is a Raspberry Pi 4. In this current video, I have booted a Raspberry Pi 4 and connected through SSH on it. First of all, we compile the simple application by having modified the makefile a little bit in order to invoke the cross compiler thanks to the cross compile suffix. We then upload the compiled binary to the target without pushing the debug information. The debug information file will be kept on the host side. In the SSH session, we launch the GDB server just like we did in the previous example. We connect on it. Again, we will put a breakpoint on the main entry point and execute the program. There is still the upload of the unknown target libraries from GDB server to GDB because it needs them to debug. We can see that the breakpoint is hit at the end, but we can continue it to have the hello world output, and that's it. As you can see, there is no significant loss of performances or efficiency, despite of the fact that the target is less powerful than the host. In the next example, we will be debugging a much bigger process, still on the Raspberry Pi 4. This time, the process is the OpenCPN application. This is an application for displaying charts in navigation. It uses X11 and OpenGL and a lot of shared library, okay, up to 180, and it is written in C++. This time, since this is a graphical application, I will do the SSH port forwarding for the X11 port. What you can see also is that there is a completion for the C++ symbol. I am putting a breakpoint in chart canvas, column column chart canvas, which is the constructor of that class. And then, when the program is started, the thing that which is happening here is that there is a synchronization with the missing library. It takes a while because there is really a bunch of them, but this is an amount of time which is acceptable because it only happened once. After a while, the breakpoint we aim is finally hit, and we already see the first graphical windows that come. I am then stepping and exiting the current function, and at the end we have the application which is launched, displaying the map. And by the way, this is the place where we live, close to the Isle of Groix. I have wanted to make a kind of evaluation of alternatives to the GDB and GDB server couple. I have identified one interesting, which is a LDDB from the Clang environment. LDDB can work in with remote connection as well. It has is a LDDB server. To my mind, the main advantage of this debugger is that it can perform an automatic upload of the debug binaries. The synchronization to the target is done when the binary is recompiled, when it changes on the host. However, I got a very bad experience from the Raspberry Pi. It was possible to debug my simple sample, but it has crashed when I wanted to debug a bigger application. When that happened, the lost connection was not detected. Also, the documentation way on how to list and delete pending or actual breakpoints didn't work. The documentation seems also outdated regarding the process launch command. As a conclusion, there is also a completion for the lookup of symbols, including the C++ symbols, but it is not user-friendly. Instead of suggesting the symbols on a single line, it presents them on a wall page in the pipe more way. So it is, to my mind, less practical than GDB does. Another alternative to GDB and GDB server that I had identified is TCF, which means the Target Communication Framework. The TCF project was initially launched at WinRiver as a replacer of the user mode agent. That project was launched, the project ID is due to Felix Burton and is actually currently maintained by Eugene Tassarov. This is a project which is hosted and integrated in Eclipse IDE. Unfortunately, I didn't have to perform a lot of tests with TCF, else I won't have time to post that video, but I just took some look at the code. It seems still maintained, as I said. It supports a lot of backends, including other backends than the ones for the Linux OS, and also it has a very cool feature, which is auto-discovery via UDP broadcast. TCF architecture is cool, but it's still unclear to me why they removed all the multi-thread logics that I had implemented in the user mode agent. I have finished to tell what I had to say about Linux debuggers. I would like to introduce something new for the ones that don't know, which is the Zephyr OS, and to make a small demo on how debugging works on it. In short words, what is Zephyr OS? Zephyr OS is a real-time OS aimed for microcontrollers. It has a very nice documentation. Most API are really similar to the ones of Linux kernel. It also supports and has device trees, but the device trees are statically compiled. Since we are on microcontrollers, usually, most of the time, we don't have Ethernet, and there is no implemented software debug agent. So that means that for debugging, you need a JTAG. and the setup of the following demo is as such. The target will be a OneSAS H2UALCB board. That board has several CPUs on it. Four Cortex A57, four A53, and a Cortex R7 on which we will run the Zephyr OS. We plug a Nolimix JTAG debug program on the board, and on the host, we run OpenOCD that makes an abstraction of the JTAG communication and provides a GDB server on which we can connect a GDB debugger. OpenOCD offers one TCP port per debug call on the target. It also has one TCP port for its internal monitoring and management. And in the coming demo, we'll see how Zephyr tools make it even easier with the WEST debug command. On the left terminal shows the project directory, where the command is just WEST build to generate the firmware to want to inject on the target. On the right, it's just a picocom running on the serial port. When you type WEST debug, it performs several things. It uploads the firmware to the board and directly connects GDB to the GDB server OpenOCD. We put a waypoint on main, we perform a continue. We have seen that the OS has started, and after stepping over the print key, you can see that the hello world is displayed. So it's as simple as debugging a Linux process. Before concluding my presentation about CoWoS debuggers, I would like to tell a little bit about two tools that I find very cool and that have saved my life a number of times. Those tools are Valgrind and LTTNG. I think that most people that already have used Valgrind know it because of his memcheck tool, which is really a really useful tool when you want to track memory leaks, for instance. But it also has profiling tools that are maybe less popular, but that can help you to track where bottlenecks are in your code when you are facing performance issue. It is worth to notice that it works well, but that kind of instrumentation has a big impact on performances. So don't expect your monitored code to be as fast as the production one. Using Valgrind is really simple. You just have to type the Valgrind command, the dash dash tool with the tool that you want to use. In this example, it is Colgrind. You eventually add other options, then your program name and your program options. When your program ends, a colgrind.out.pid file is generated that can be processed with a kcachegrind tool. Kcachegrind is a graphical tool that will show up the call graph of your functions with the amount of time spent in each function. So when should you use Valgrind? I would say all the time, and that would must be in your CI. A special attention must be paid for the memcheck exclusion rules. For more information, please go to Glow and see the Valgrind documentation. Another tool which is really cool is LTTNG. I really like their logo and find their mole very cute. The slogan of LTTNG can be instrument twice and investigate. It can perform either kernel or user space instrumentation. In my case, it has saved my life in the past when I was chasing very nasty kernel scheduling issues. A typical example that LTTNG can solve is that when you are getting scheduling or priority inversion issues, or when you want to chase IRQ storms. There are other known alternatives to LTTNG, just like F2ACE, S2ACE, and PERF, but they are not such as cool. I mean, they are not as easy to use, And maybe the strength of LTNG is that it can combine both userland and kernel traces, and it's especially useful when you have an application that relies on the dedicated kernel. LTTNG is composed of three things: the LTTNG tools, LTTNG modules, which are kernel modules, and LTTNG UST. It was a real because it implements high performance buffers based on the RCU technology. Starting with LTTNG is quite easy. The documentation is very well written, just have to follow the mole. You need to add some specific kernel options, config modules of course, but config iOS timers is mandatory, and config trace points of course. By the way, config trace points is not visible in kconfig, but it is activated implicitly by config ftrace. Config ftrace just adds 5 byte NOPS operation addition to entry. It has no performance in fact. In a nutshell, on this slide, I show how with 4 commands you can get your first LTTNG trace. Got one file of trace by your CPU core. For using that trace, you can either use Babel Trace 2 or the best graphical application, which is Trace Compass. Trace Compass was formerly an Eclipse plugin, and now it is still at eclipse.org, but it is a standalone application. As you can see, the application shows which thread or which CPU is active at one time, or it is when it is preempted by an IR queue, with some statistics. We have finally reached the end of the presentation. I hope it was interesting. I would like to thank everybody for their attention. We'll now start the question and answer session. So please feel free to ask anything you have got in mind, and I will try to answer. If you come to France, please visit us. This next picture I show again the place where we live. So we'll be happy to show you our beautiful country.